How about the next one? B?
Can you explain that one? I thought, why isn't it B?
Why isn't it B? Well, this ring has a deactivating group, this ring has an activating group. This ring's gonna be more reactive.
Oh, that's a T.
Orthosphere director, D. Nitration, nitric acid, protonate. Kick off the water. There's a nitronium ion. This pi bond attacks the nitronium ion by swinging out the cation here. And then something takes the H and the electrons move back in. You can use this and reform H2SO4. You can use water and form H3O plus. It's the same thing. You did not have to show resonance structures. Did not ask you for that.
Question to the one before. Couldn't that be added in effect to like B? Because it would have a meta director on the left side, and it would have a fourth director with the aromatic ring on the right. So that would be like two things compared to like one for everything else. Like for C and D.
That's reasonable thinking.
So would you consider giving credit for B?
I've changed that question. That's sometimes these have to be.
Talk about number three. Yeah. Yeah. B. I like B.
B.
Yeah.
That's what I said. That's
not the reason. I mean, meta director is not the reason.
Oh, just because it's
added. Oh, ortho.
You ruined it. I didn't ruin anything. It also works because ortho pair. Because it added them. Because that's also.
Let me think.
Let me think about it.
Nitration, pretty straightforward. How do you do?
Good.
I'll return Winston's lab. At the end of class, sulfanilamide. By the way, the sulfanilamide, those of you that had iodo, one or two of you asked about this. There it is. This was the sulfanilamide. This was the di-iodo product. And look at this peak here. This is one of the aromatic carbons. Those that had the iodo product. What is this? You can hardly see it. 80? Like 80 ppm. Is that aromatic region for carbon?
No.
No, we're down here. But that's an aromatic carbon. It's the iodine zone. Why is it so far upfield? Because iodine has all those electrons around it. Core electrons, valence electrons, all those electrons around the big iodine shield the carbon so much. Electron shield. Look how far upfield it moved that. Any textbook you see is going to say aromatics are about 120 to 150. Well, that ain't 120 to 150. Right? It's a huge upfield shift due to the iodine. Bromine doesn't quite isn't shifted as much. Chlorine is not as much. Fluorine actually is more downfield because fluorine is more electronegative. Okay. Let's see where we left off at. The coral colored sheet. Benzyne, any questions about benzyne chemistry?
I have a question about the lab.
Benzyne, I think we pretty much finished it up. Questions about that handout?
Questions about the lab. Are you going to teach us how to read FNMRs?
One thing at a time. Let's get there. Any questions about the coral sheet? There we were displacing a more traditional leaving group. We had two mechanisms, NAS and benzyne. There were some warm-up questions. I sent you out an email that had the answers to a couple of warm-up pages. I also sent you a, included in that was the NMRs for the lab, all there. Okay, please read the guidelines to what is required for that. You can get started, okay? I'm giving you that as now rather than later. Also, there's the assignment due. I gave you a due date. Okay, I think it's the first three reactions, a summary table. Okay, final report, you have to have a summary table for all your reactions. So I'm trying to get you started on that. The other thing was something about discovery of benzene by Michael Faraday. Can I take a look at that? You know, Faraday did lots of physics also, right? Faraday's laws, okay, but he also discovered benzene. To read that, it's very fascinating. Hopefully you find it fascinating. He talks about how he was distilling it. He couldn't get a pure fraction, although he didn't call it pure fraction. He called it like constant boiler. I don't know what he called it, but he was, you can interpret it as he couldn't get a pure fraction. And then he would redistill it and get different boiling points, and he's like, it won't be a constant boiling point. Okay, it's the same struggles that you deal with when you're distilling today, trying to get a constant fraction. But then he did some experiments. And if you read it, he came up with the formula of, a pure formula of C2H. What's the pure formula of benzene? What's the empirical formula of benzene? Well, the molecular formula is CH8-6, but empirical formula is what? The lowest common denominator. Yeah, CH. He came up with this, though. Well, he's actually right, because back then, chemists considered molecular weight of carbon to be not 12, but 6. So it took twice as many carbons to equal 12. So he actually got it right. But he also went on to actually also get, basically, he figured out that there was, he figured out also basically the formula. Now he didn't get it right because he had this wrong, but he essentially got it right. How did he do that? Well, hopefully you learned about that in gym chem. But he's all talks about that. By the way, he didn't call his compound benzene. What did he call it? He called it bicarbonate of hydrogen. Two carb hydrogen. Because he knew that it had just carbon and hydrogen. How did he know it didn't contain oxygen? Maybe. Well, read about it.
Where did you discover the residue of lanterns?
Well, the whale oil.
The whale oil.
Yeah. I mean, they burned it in the lanterns, but also if you burned it in a closed system, it would give off a residue. Basically, if you distill whale oil,
okay,
you can get this stuff out of it. And they would partially do that, and then they would take the distillate and burn it in the lamps. But if you further distilled it, or back then they said rectified it, keep rectifying it until you get something pure out of it. You get benzene out of it. You can get other things.
You said that
Yeah, there was another one because this was called bicarbonate of hydrogen. Back then on, there was another molecule of bicarbonate of hydrogen. Did you come up with it?
What?
Acetylene, yes. Acetylene. The empirical formula being what? CH. But again, back then, they thought it was C2H. Because they got it wrong, even back then. This is another compound that has the same empirical formula of benzene, but this is a gas at room temperature. Now, empirical formulas you can determine. And they both come out to be C2H, and so do they. So they both have the same composition. They both were called bicarbonate of hydrogen, but this one was they called it the gaseous bicarbonate of hydrogen because it was a gas. Okay, let's get back to lab. We'll talk a little bit about fluorine NMR down the road. Pretty much we already talked enough in the handout.
So is the most common way to synthesize benzene nowadays through Diels Alder?
No, benzene is obtained from petroleum distillates, coal tar. It's made from other ways like decarboxylation of benzoic acid or demethylation of toluene. It's a variety of ways. Well, you know, that's a good question. A lot of these come from coal tar. I mean, oil industry. Okay. Where's methane come from? Well, if you go dig an oil well, and what comes off first? Methane. A lot of times they just burn it off in the fields.
Cow dung also.
You know? So it's important to think, where does everything come from originally? Okay, let's get into it. Benzylic chemistry. I think we're done with that handout. Benzylic chemistry. Okay. Well, I'd like to turn to the back first, because you need to get started on multi-step synthesis. And the first few do not require any benzylic chemistry. How do you synthesize this compound starting with benzene?
You add bromine first. You brominate it.
We want to think retrosynthesis. Remember, go backwards. Because this is a very important frame of thinking approach. Let's go backwards. Let's take off one group. Let's see, why don't we take off that group? Or let's go this way. Let's take off that group. Now come forward. Can we put a bromine on, what is this, ethyl benzene?
Yeah.
Can we brominate here?
No.
Why not?
It's an
ortho para directory. It's not going to go meta. What about over here?
Yeah, you can do that.
This is also an ortho para directory.
So you have to do diazonium reaction.
Both of these are ortho para directors. You cannot put the other group on, it's meta.
Could you do a reaction?
Diazonium.
Well, this one right off the bat makes us think about something. What is a precursor to one of these groups? And is a precursor a meta director?
Acylation.
Do we have a precursor to this? No. Do we have a precursor to this?
Yeah. Acylation.
Aldehyde.
Not an aldehyde, but. Consider a precursor, this, because we know if we had that, we can remove the oxygen to get that. Well, what type of director is this?
Meta.
So now we start thinking, at this point I would just move away from the retrosynthesis and say, okay, if we had this, how would we make this? What do we want to do first?
Clemmensen or?
You want to brominate while you have it in this form. Bromine with a little iron. That will give the bromo acetophenone, 3-bromoacetophenone, metabromoacetophenone. Then how do we get this?
Clemmensen, Wolf, Koch, or H2PDC.
Yes, you can do hydrogenation. You can do Wolf-Kishner. What's the third one?
Clemmensen.
Zinc with mercury and HCl. What's that called?
Clemmensen
reduction. Very classical. That'll remove the oxygen. Give you that. Okay?
Yeah, that's a free one.
We got to start with benzene. Start with benzene. How do we make this? That's just Friedel Crafts with the methyl ketone. It's not a methyl ketone, it's the acyl chloride. ALCl3, and there we go.
That's not bad.
Make the ketones, brominate it, then reduce the ketone, remove the oxygen. And note, in our synthesis,
Nowhere did we ever have ethylbenzene. And nowhere did we ever have bromobenzene. We went through a precursor that had the correct directing effects. Yes, we had three different ways. This is more textbook. That Wolf Fisher is more textbook. Hydrogenation is usually not noted in textbooks, but it is. Okay. Let's try the next one. Once you do it up, try it on your own. What is that? 3-iodoaniline? There you go.
We didn't have a benzone. Did he cover diazonium reaction? No. How are we supposed to do that?
You could just protonate it. When you protonate that, then it's a
metadirector. Yeah. No, but that's not efficient.
Huh?
It's not efficient.
Oh,
you're not
looking
for
efficient. So I don't know.
Now you could possibly say I'm going to protonate that and make it a meta director.
Can you not?
I mean, it's
that has some issues. Don't do that. Go back to the iodo. Can we put this on? No. Orthopara.
That's why.
And diazonium.
Orthopara director. Orthopara director. Do we have a precursor to either one of these?
Yes.
Yes.
Nitro.
Yes, we have nitro. Nitro would be a meta director.
And then you put the ion, and then you reduce that with the FNSL. That's what we were saying.
So you want to iodinate here. Iodine and what?
CuCl.
Copper chloride. I think we also said maybe hydrogen peroxide.
And then you change the NO2 to with iron.
That would give this meta director, and then we get to here with what?
Iron.
What about zinc and ammonium chloride?
That works too.
Would that work?
That works too.
I don't know, it might. How do we make this?
HNO.
Well, that's just benzene using nitric acid and H2SO4. Maybe you could just do it with just nitric acid. Typically with benzene, it's not as reactive as fluorine or something else. So again, we used a precursor that had the correct directing effect. Okay. Questions about that one? Okay, there's others for you to do. Next two seem like maybe you want to use some benzoic chemistry we're about to talk about. The one on the bottom is actually, remember your test one chemistry.
Yeah.
That's ether out here on the end. That's test one chemistry. It's combining test one and test two. Think about that one. There's others on the back that you can start doing. Benzoic chemistry, this one down here, maybe benzoic chemistry, but maybe not. It doesn't have to be. How's the one on the bottom? How would you make this?
Polyalkylation.
No, it doesn't even work.
Bromo is just
you do diazonium, right?
But once you put one on.
No, that's wrong.
It's an organic.
Where's the next one going to go? That's ortho para director. Next one should go ortho or para. How are they all going meta?
Magic.
How would you do this?
Would you
substitute?
Like MS
yeah.
Or
like a weird.
I don't know.
How would you do that?
That's how we meet TNT.
Think about this. Have we ever said there's a group that you could put on and then take back off?
Yeah. So group three.
Sulfon.
What type of group can you put on and then take back off?
Sulfonation. And then reverse it.
And if you put on a sulfonic acid group, what type of directory would that be?
That's a meta.
Meta. And maybe you could.
But how would you
so how?
Well, maybe that would work, maybe it wouldn't, but if you put it on,
use
it, and then get rid of it.
Yeah.
And then you'd have to do it three
times. Let it direct, but then at the end, you're rid of it.
Yeah, use HBR instead of like your...
I don't know if that'll work or not.
Oh.
Maybe, but maybe we need some other group that we can put on and take off. In this handout, we'll see another group that you can put on and take off. Maybe it would be better because it has different directive effects. But that's an example where you're going to have some group there to direct and then get then take it back off. Okay. That's why that one was last. Okay, let's look at the beginning. Benzoic chemistry. Benzoic chemistry referring to the traditionally the carbon that's attached to the benzene ring. But it could also be maybe something else attached to the benzene ring, like nitrogen. Okay? Traditionally, though, carbon. And the first thing we're going to look at is benzoic bromination. And we actually, I believe, we looked at this in Organic 1 at the very end when we did radical bromination. If you take toluene, bromine, and light, which implies radicals, you can get this here. You can substitute the benzoic carbon with a bromine. You're replacing an H, and thus the byproduct is going to be HBr, and this is called a benzoic bromination. Very common reaction. I'm pretty sure if you look back at the radical bromination handout at the end of Organic 1, this very same thing was covered. That handout also said instead of using bromine, we could use NBS and bromocyclamide with light. Both of these produce bromine radicals. Now you can also use a peroxide. This is benzoyl peroxide. Bromine radicals. Bromine radicals, you're going to brominate the benzylic. In this example down here, we brominate the benzylic carbon. I'm doing a monobromination here. If you used excess reagents, you could get di or even tri if you had three. You could dibrominate here. Up here, you could even tribrominate. But here, I'm just showing mono. Now, before we show mechanism, I'll just make this note. This is radical reaction, indicated with the light or the peroxide, radical. Where over here, this is ionic. This is our traditional EAS, which all of your intermediates are ions. So with the Lewis acid, you're doing ring bromination. The lighter peroxide, which implies radical, you're doing benzylic radical bromination. So don't confuse those two. Mechanism, I'll do from the bottom here. Okay, this generates bromine radicals. For bromine, here's bromine. You put in a little energy, and this bond will rupture one electron here, and you get bromine with one electron. This is called homolytic bond cleavage. Of course, you get two of these because each one's the same. Same, homolytic. This can be done with light or peroxide. With light, it's energy coming in here. With peroxide, it's a little bit other than just energy. It's not going to go into it, but either way, you get the bromine radicals. You can also get bromine radicals from using NBS. I'm not going to say any more about it. Of course, some of you used NCS in the sulfa lab, chlorinate. Okay, you can get all these, NCS, NBS, or NIS. All are available. NBS is commonly used. Why? Because bromine is a fairly corrosive, toxic liquid. If you spill it, you're going to have a mess. NBS is a nice dry solid. If you spill it, you just sweep it up and you're good. So it's a convenience. Okay, once we get our bromine radicals, we have H's here. The bromine radical will strip an H out, or abstract would be maybe a more scientific term. One electron here. One electron here. The other electron stays behind on the carbon. And so the electron stays behind on the carbon, and we made what? HBr. With the H and one electron teamed up with the bromine and one electron to make a covalent bond. There's your HBr we said you would make. We basically form radical in our substrate, but we form it here. Why is that the best place to form radical? Just like a cation, it's stabilized here, just like a cation would be, a carbocation. You can do resonance of radicals. For example, one of these electrons moved here to team up with that one, the other one moved here. Put radical here, but you can keep going. You can then put radical here and here. Basically, at this point, what's the hybridization of this radical here?
Trick question.
Treat that just like if it was a long pair. If that was a long pair, what type of orbital would the long pair want to be in?
The
orbital, the orbital next door. Well, same thing as a single electron. The single electron is going to want to be in a p orbital. So basically, you have six p orbitals, seven, they're all interacting. Once they're all interacting, it's one system, but we can show fake resonance structures of that one system. Okay, what do we need to do to get the final product?
Termination.
We could have this team up with a bromine radical. These two team up, final product, right?
Yeah.
Why is that not right? What did we learn in Organic 1 about radical reactions? Radical reactions tend to be self-propagating. That is, you only need the light at the very beginning, then you can turn it off and the reaction keeps going. How does it keep going? If we did this, we would need light to then bust the next molecule of bromine.
You just need to initiate first.
It doesn't. Instead, it reacts with bromine. We get rid of the light, and now we can react just with this. One electron here, one electron here, the other electron there. What does that give? That gives that, but importantly, what do we produce?
Another bromine radical.
We produce bromine radical. Then it can come back over here
and attack another bromine.
And we now have a cycle. And so we have propagation.
Do what? I thought that one formed HBr up there.
Use up. Do what now?
That original bromine radical formed HBr.
When you initiate first, you form HBr.
Yeah.
Then I draw it.
You drop it down there.
You form it when you first initiate.
Well, that forms HBR, but then you need another rearrange radical to do it. I mean, this gets replaced 100 gazillion times. We're replacing it with the one we formed. And after this one extracts H, you're going to have another HBR, but you make a gazillion HBRs in the reaction. So this over here with the light would be called what? Initiation. And then we have propagation. Now you could have a third step which ends your propagation called what? Termination. That would be something that ends your cycle. For example, what if two bromines came together? Two bromine radicals came together and made bromine. Well, that would be trying to end your cycle. What if two of these carbon radicals came together? That's possible. A side product from this reaction could be what if this was a product? Could you envision how this might have been formed? This is where two of these radicals here came together and made bond, right? We made this bond right there. Well, if that happened, that would be a termination step because it would terminate this. You might argue maybe it wouldn't because maybe there's more of these. If you read about this in details, you can find things. It'll even talk about maybe bromine radicals reacting with your glassware. Glassware is a chemical, right? It's mainly silicon-based. But ever worry about your reagents reacting with your flask? Well, in some cases, you do have to worry about that. For example, if you ever use HF, you can't use a glass. It'll react with the glass. Plastic, brown bottoms, Teflon. Sometimes you even do it in some type of inert metals. There are some metals that, like a gold flask. Gold is inert. Yeah, think about it. I mean, question.
You mentioned the initiation and propagation
stuff.
In the mechanism that you showed, where does the initiation start and stop?
Initiation was the homolytic cleavage of bromine by the light. And everything else. You can also call this the first maybe initiation of.
Could you terminate propagation by submerging the reaction in extremely cold temperatures?
Possibly. I mean, if you just slow it down, depends on what happens to the radicals that were formed. Does the bromine go back? Bromine radicals go back to bromine. In practice, you often leave the light on the entire time. But it's been shown that you can turn it off, and the reaction will keep going. Okay. We covered that in Organic 1. That's hopefully a refresher. Please look back at that. Benzylic bromination. Why do we not do benzylic chlorination, et cetera? Chlorine tends to be too reactive. It won't be selective. You'll end up chlorinating out here because it'll form radicals just about anywhere. Iodine is just too unreactive. Fluorine, too reactive. Turns out the thermodynamics is just good for bromination. It's thermodynamically driven enough to be a good reaction, but it's not too exothermic to not give you selectivity for your benzylic position. Okay, why would we want to put a bromine on there? Well, now you have a good leaving group for traditional SN2 chemistry. React this with KCN. Y'all remember KCN, right? Mm-hmm. Yep. KCN, the sunshine band? SN2, right? Cyanide displaces the bromine, good old SN2. then later on we can do chemistry of the nitrile when we get over to test three. What is this? Potassium tert-butoxide, what would that do here? What is this commonly used for? Yeah, it's common E2. So once we get the bromine on, we can then do good old traditional substitution elimination chemistry over there. We can work it into multi-step synthesis. It's really just the last reaction. Can you show the product of this?
Probably.
Product of that four-step sequence?
First step is three del, correct?
Show the product of that there.
Just
please have it next time. We're about out of time. Okay, next time we'll look at benzylic oxidation. And we'll also get the diazonium chemistry, which is on the next couple of pages. The diazonium chemistry will be more extensive. There's several reactions that can be done there. There's mechanisms for forming the diazonium. Please be looking at it. We'll hit hard on Monday. On Mondays, next week in lab, you're doing a diazonium reaction with your amino. Okay? Please plan on doing the diazonium reaction to make the iodo compound.